Mars will most likely be the next giant leap for mankind, but it's not certain that the feet that will step onto it will belong to a man or a woman. The development of the Robonaut, humanoid robots that will go to Mars in our place, is well underway. Some experts say they are cheaper, safer, and more effective than sending humans to the red planet. So, will a living, breathing person ever set foot on Mars? It was difficult enough getting to the moon, just 239,000 miles or 385,000 kilometers away from Earth. That's nothing compared to the 34 million miles or 55 million kilometers distance to Mars, and that's at its closest approach. Get the timing wrong, and that increases to nearly 250 million miles or 400 million kilometers. Since 1960, there have been 55 missions to the red planet. Of those, 25 have failed, another 4 have partially failed. 8 machines remain in operation on or around Mars, with the Opportunity rover launched in 2003 and the Curiosity rover launched in 2011 being the only operational robots on the planet. In the skies above Mars, there are 6 orbiters monitoring the weather and geological patterns. But all those are pretty old tech. Within the next 2 decades, it's hoped that the exploration of Mars will be taken over by Robonauts. Engineers have been working on human-shaped robots that offer all the advantages of the latest technology, plus the ability to work alongside humans. Humanoid machines can be used to simulate the experience of humans in extreme conditions, offering more information on how to protect people if they should ever go there. One of the key developments in Robonauts was Asimo, unveiled by the Honda Corporation in 2000. Asimo is the size of a 12-year-old boy and capable of walking, running, and even dancing like a human. Technology took a huge leap forward as a result of the DARPA Robotics Challenge contest, which took place between 2012 and 2015. Entries were invited that could complete 8 tasks focused around search and rescue operations on Earth, including being able to drive a vehicle, walk across rubble, open doors, climb ladders, and use tools. The contest led to the creation of androids that could pick themselves up if they fell over, communicate using speech recognition and facial expressions, and move in a realistic human way. But NASA's Robonaut series appear to have achieved the most. They were built with the idea of working in space alongside humans in mind. Robonaut 1 came in 2 versions between 1997 and 2002 and explored the use of teleoperation. They could be remotely controlled by a user who was elsewhere. Due to its human-like hands and arms, it didn't need specially designed tools and could use the ones that astronauts used. But R1 was basically a torso that could be attached to a base with wheels, so it wasn't fully capable of human motion. Neither was R2, but the later model proved so successful that it was flown to the International Space Station in 2012. The R2 began working on basic tasks through the use of telepresence, a complex system of cameras, sensors, and feedback suppliers that gave the remote operators the feeling that they were actually there with the robot. R2 was designed to be capable of moving and even working outside the ISS, but the framework to make it truly mobile wasn't supplied, although it did get a pair of legs later in its mission. The latest Robonaut is the R5, also known as the Valkyrie, which was based on the search and rescue principles of the DARPA contest, but also with the exploration of Mars in mind. 4 Valkyries have been built. Each Valkyrie is 6 feet tall, weighs 300 pounds or 136 kilos, and costs around $2 million to build. Each contains nearly 200 sensors to provide feedback and 28 torque-controlled joints to mimic human movement. But there are still problems with sending Robonauts to Mars. Latency is the biggest one. It takes 3.5 minutes at the shortest distance between Earth and Mars, and 22 minutes at the longest distance for the signal to go just one way, and in the same amount of time to return. That rules out real-time operation by telepresence. It's hoped that improvements in artificial intelligence will help solve the problem, although it won't cure it completely. Cost is another issue. Sending a robot to Mars instead of a human is cheaper, because a robot doesn't need life support systems or supplies that a person does, and it doesn't need to come back to Earth. But one of the main reasons the Apollo missions to the moon were funded was because people were going. The human adventure made the prospect exciting for the public, and the international tensions of the space race era meant there were political and military advantages to covering the costs. If we're not sending men to Mars, who wants to pay for it? As Professor Stephen Hawking said in 2009,
robotic missions do not catch the public imagination in the same way, and they do not spread the human race into space, which should be our long-term strategy. We will have to bold go where no one has gone before.
It's also not fully accepted that robots are better than people in the first place. Along with the speed of human decision-making and reactions, it's argued that people are more cost-effective when you evaluate how much scientific information they retrieve per dollar spent. In 2005, the UK's Royal Astronomic Survey Commission on the Scientific Case for Human Space Exploration discussed the topic. They argued that in 1972, the astronauts of Apollo 17 travelled 36 kilometres across the moon's surface, while the Opportunity rover has taken 8 years to cover almost the same distance on Mars. They pointed out that with no return requirement for robots, no material from the surface of Mars had yet been brought back to Earth, compared to nearly 400 kilograms of moon samples. In 2007, an experiment took place at the Horton Impact Crater in Canada, where a human in a spacesuit worked alongside a rover operated by telepresence. In the test, the human was found to be between 10 and 100 times more effective than the machine, which was more advanced than anything on Mars at the time. Steve Squires, who was part of the Opportunity team, admitted that most things a rover could do in a day could be done by a human in less than a minute. It was also argued that the robot missions weren't getting cheaper as expected. It's always been assumed that the miniaturization of technology would make probes smaller and lighter. But as our need to discover more specific information increased, the type of experiments we need to send became heavier, and the probes actually became bigger and therefore more expensive to send. So, robot or human, or robot and human? It looks like Robonauts could go to Mars first to pave the way for humans. Then, when humans arrive, they'll work alongside their automated friends. But there is a compromise option. Instead of going all the way to Mars, astronauts might set up base on one of the planet's moons, Phobos or Deimos, then send robots to the surface to be operated by telepresence from a much closer distance than Earth. But the idea of humans going nearly all the way to Mars and not quite getting there, perhaps for decades afterwards, isn't going to sit well with the fans of human adventure and, ultimately, the ones bankrolling the missions. Meanwhile, the next stage of robotic development could be unveiled shortly with the final round of NASA's Space Robotic Challenge. 20 teams will compete to operate a virtual Valkyrie robot in a Martian environment, complete with the latency issues they would have to face in real life. The winning team gets $1 million, but the advance in the field of robonautics is the real prize. So, thanks for watching, and I would just like to say that this episode's shirt is a Trip Flames by Madcap England and is available from Atom Retro with worldwide shipping from here in the UK. And also, don't forget, we have the Curious Droid Facebook page and group where you can suggest ideas for new videos, and the link is on the channel page. And you can also translate any of the videos with the community contributions, which we have a video on if you're unsure of in the uploaded video section. So as always, thanks for watching, and please subscribe, rate, and share.